Mr. Chairman, and dear colleagues.
I try to be on my time for a long story. We start with an anatomy lesson of Rembrandt, because what I am going to say will be just in details, like an anatomy lesson. And we start from a global view of different kind. Different kind of tumors in geographic differentiations. Of course, this is very important for the etiologies, since there were the famous esophagus cancer in Liangxin Valley in China, or the cervical cancer in the south of America, or in the south of Asia, and so on. And I think it's very important, since I'm a virologist, to look at virosphere with different viruses, because in the 60s and the 70s, finally was possible to associate some viruses to human cancer. And of course, there are a list of these proven viruses, as well as suspect and maybe some possible. Of course, I mean, there were in the possibility to find a vaccine, that is the main topic of our conference. And we start with hepatitis B virus, and then we'll go on papilloma virus. And of course, I mean, it's important to use the antigen in excess produced during replication of infectious hepatitis B virus to get one good vaccine for this kind of infectious disease. But what is very important also, that for some hepatoma were able not to produce, because in a retrospective studies was possible to show that some of the liver cancer were bound to the this virus. Of course, we know that there is also another virus of hepatitis, like C-type, or eventually there are other etiology causes. But what is important, in a retrospective studies, was possible to show that this vaccine was able to act. Of course, I mean, this was a retrospective studies, but now we show another kind of virus, the papilloma virus. This, in this case, will be a perspective studies, because we know that there are these special proteins in the papilloma virus that are able to inhibit the oncosuppressor in the replication of not only of the virus, but of the transformation. So these are able, the oncosuppressor, to stop and to make the oncogenes to send their malignant message. And as you know, in 2006, the 6th of June, the FDA was able to register a new vaccine that is able to protect maybe 80% of the cervical cancer, that in the world is the second cause of death for ladies. Now we start a little back in the study, like in the 60s, where was important to study some of the oncogenic viruses for animals, and polyoma, that is able, don't forget, to produce 23 different types of tumors in hamsters, that transformed cells were able to transplant the tumors. But if the animal was injected before with the virus, was protected, unless the newborn animals was for maybe immunodeficit going to the tumors. So the problem of the protection of the animal after the transformed cells transplanted, if it was first injected with polyoma virus, was to produce a special antigen, said transplant antigen. On this hypothesis, there were different kind of possible mechanism for tumor recognition and rejection. So the antigen presenting cells, especially for the CD4, and was able to, for cellular immunity, able to produce cytotoxic effect on tumor cells, as well the humoral immunity. As you know, Professor Fiudurio was dividing the body with the two arms, one humoral, the other cellular immunity. So in this case, it was the basis to think that something could be done more on cellular immunity, maybe. And then we have a long story that, of course, I'll try to be too short. Since it's already end of the 18th century, when William Cooley found first that there was the possibility to stimulate the immune system, then the great Paul Herrick said that the new system may suppress tumor development, as well as after many years was something in the hypothesis that animals and men have cells, transformed cells, that could stimulate the specific humoral and cellular antibodies. Of course, we go straight to the viruses when immunogenesis of a subtransplantation antigen from adenovirus 12 induced tumor cells demonstrated in inbred hamsters, and Halligan and other people were the first to show this kind of finding. And then, of course, there were in the 70s the important discovery of the Cambridge people concerning monoclonal antibody, Miles Stein, Peruzzi, today still Greg Winter working on this. And of course, at the same time, the possibility that a molecule like interferon, that is, as you know, is produced after viral infection of the cells, if produced in great dose, was able eventually to protect from some tumors, not only from infections, and what is important, was able to be produced in by inserting coding gene into bacteria. At this point, of course, there is a therapeutic vaccine strategy as the tumor cells can be removed from patient treated biochemically or irradiated. The first cases, some patients were shown to act like this from in oncology at the beginning of the 80s. Of course, I mean, at the same time, interferon is approved by FDA for the treatment of hairy cell leukemia, as well as the protein, liberated protein, had a great potential to serve, at least hypothetically, as a lung cancer vaccine. And now we go still with new FDA OKs, like the first monoclonal antibody against cancer, and still the accepting for the treatment of metastatic breast cancer. Then we O1 and the, we know NCI, the Rosenberg group were studying the CD4, CD8 for the treatment against cancer, as well for the first time, according to Professor Herbermann, the antibody for protein liberated tumor was able, I mean, to be shown in the sera of human beings. Of course, this makes us with a new strategy. In this case, not any longer cell extracts, but peptides and proteins could be useful. In this case, there was the possibility to have a development of a vaccine approach for therapeutic and preventive application. So we have the possibility that the dendritic cell presents the right antigen, the CD4 can release interleukin and as well as in interaction with CD8 cells, prompting them to attack other cells with the same antigen. At this point, we have a new strategy that the dendritic cells of a cancer patient are removed and loaded with antigen from the tumor. Of course, at this point, we have a few years ago, the FDA approved the first therapeutic cancer vaccine for advanced prostate cancer. So after this long story, we know that there is the interleukin 2, that as you know, is a pharmaceutical drug that can be used for inhibit melanoma and kidney carcinoma with clear cells, as well as, you know, there is different studies for a melanoma vaccine. At this point, if you remember a previous slide of the New York Academy of Science, according to that hypothesis, this already is an operative way to understand the problem. Of course, I mean, now I go not in details, but straight to a figures that we try to show you as possible from tumor cells to have the extractions for proteins that in vitro are able to have a mitogenic activity, as with the concavalin and so on, as well as you have in vivo in the same patients or patients with the same histologic type of tumor, we can produce a delayed hypersensitivity. Of course, if we go straight to the blood, we can look for antigen and the specific antibody, this could be a biological marker. Of course, I mean, there are other activities bound to this kind of peptide, and like different papers shown some activity in apoptosis or in androgenic inhibition, or as well some similarity with the interleukins. Of course, I mean, it's important to purify the activity, not in protein extracts, but especially identified protein. And so some of the work was done at Cold Spring Harbor, and we used a specific anti-serum produced by Dr. Marshak to be able to make in in pathology studies, according to immunoperoxidase, the possibility of a reactivity, especially with the specific anti-serum for adenocarcinoma and non-small cell lung cancer, but negative for microcytoma. Another peptide was prepared always in Cold Spring Harbor, and in this case was repeated the same experiments using the new anti-serum, and we have again a positive for lung carcinoma and not for other kind of cancer, but some people in Rome, the group of Dr. Gelaci, try to have some positivity in colon carcinoma. So we can see that, of course, there are some positivity, as you can say, from the staining, from epithelial carcinoma or with adenocarcinoma. We have the possibility also to use in the initial fibrosis of lung of tumors when eventually there is the transformation, and the adenocarcinoma from the colon. We have no positive results in breast carcinoma as well as in urogenital carcinoma. We tried also, since there was some similarity in the molecular amino acids composition with corin, to look for a muscle interaction, and you have maybe some kind of myocardium positivity with a special anti-serum prepared. In any case, of course, I mean, was the fashion to look for biomarkers, and in a seminar I gave in Germany, in Munich, at the Roche Institute, possible eventually to prospect some kind of these studies, as well was done in different hospitals and university clinicals, and especially trying to study the specificity and the sensitivity with different kind of results that, of course, were much better obtained in San Francisco by Billy Yoon, according to a microarray with a very good, specificity, in this case 100%, against a fair positivity for what concerns the positivity here that we can say according between 50% and 60%. Of course, was the main object was to go inside the components of the protein, and then we were able to show that one of the peptides that were studied in Cold Spring Harbor was able to be repeatedly found in different tumors, so that Herbermann stated that this protein was overexpressed in lung tumor and other epithelial adenocarcinomas, as well as was immunogenic in humans, since it was evidenced by sera antibodies. Of course, the experiments go on. And so we have a new group of antibody prepared by Rockland Immunochemicals in such a way to perform different positivity, not from tumor extracts, but straight from non-small cell cancer cultured in vitro. At this point, it was important to verify with a competition assay. And so we can show that at different time, at least in two of these lines, we can repeat the experiment with the monomer, the 50,000 kilodaltons. The 100 kilodaltons was used by Herbermann, and now our previous paper of 1983, according to a measure at that time of 214 kilodaltons. At this point, of course, will be important to immunoprecipitate the protein from the cell lysate and load it on the page gel, and then we could found finally a very nice protein around 55,000 Dalton. Of course, we have the pleasure to ask Professor King Fu to give us a plasmid that he prepared for using corins. As you know, there are different types of corins, and we were able in the possible to have a practically to make a plasmid and then transinfect ourselves. And now we are at the point that we can say that we have at least one amino acid of difference. So at this point, we are trying to see, to establish once and for all, if the proteins are same or are different, and there are studies in course at the Hamburg University, and I hope that maybe next meeting I can say something the end of this story, so we avoid the scream of Munch and we'll have a better view with Tiziano, with peace and love. Thank you. Almost on time.
Can I just ask you a couple of questions? There are two things that are on my mind when I hear this kind of talk. One is that the first thing that happens to a patient with cancer is that the cancer is excised and you obviously can use the tissues, but then people are treated with chemotherapy and radiotherapy. So you've got radiotherapy and chemotherapy, which does affect the way the immune system responds. So from a practical point of view, a patient comes to the hospital, got a cancer, you whip it out, and now you've got a lump of tissue. You can take as much blood as you like, so you can separate out the macrophages and the dendritic cells and the monocytes, etc. And in essence, you have to have a laboratory in the hospital that's a cell culture laboratory, which hospitals don't have, because they're no good at cell culture, because they've never done it in their lives, in the hospital itself to do patient-specific generation of macrophages and dendritic cells, having been exposed to some kind of homogenate of the stuff that is the actual cancer that's just been excised by surgery. Am I right in thinking that is the process so far? So you don't really need to know what protein it is. In fact, it's probably bad to know what protein it is because it makes you too specific, too expensive, too long-winded, and it's a real mess. And it's not generic necessarily because we learned yesterday that cancers genetically are inhomogeneous. Even within the cancer itself, there's terrific genetic inhomogeneity. So you're not going to get a uniform, if you like, cancer immunogen from any one particular cancer tissue or that will be responsible for a number of cancer tissues. So don't you think it's time really for you to concentrate more on how you make a hospital laboratory which is good for cell culture, good for doing this, and tell them whether or not they can apply chemotherapy and or radiotherapy before they begin messing about with injecting the sensitized macrophages and dendritic cells? Sorry, it was a long question, but you see what I'm getting at. I'm getting at more immediate thing. I'm cutting out the science. The science is not necessary. What is necessary is the technology for actually curing patients in an individualized laboratory setting within an individual hospital in the boondocks in Indiana.
I think you're right, especially because we must concern according not only genetic, but also epigenetic of cancer today. We know how as important it is. But the multidisciplinary approach is very important. As we know always, we always talk of early diagnosis, because surgery, radiotherapy, and chemotherapy act much better. But we could complete in a very good hospital, as we did in our small hospital in Naples, with some select patients, some therapeutic approach that give us the starting point to go on this, especially for people that is nothing else to do, not even with chemotherapy and so on.
So, in essence, what I'm looking for you to do is to define the protocol that every hospital should be operating and to design the laboratory facility in which this kind of thing goes on. How many technicians do you need? What kind of autoclaves, etc., etc., etc.? That is the package that has to be sold with this kind of approach.
I think especially I don't want to make anything special that you write, but we now have this kind of collaborative studies with Hamburg, and as you know, Germany are very straight on this, and maybe we could find something.
Okay, good. Are there any other questions for Dr. Tarro? Okay, let's go on now to...
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was very interesting.